Welcome back to chapter 4 of the Introduction to Python Programming course. This chapter is on recursion and looping. Recursion and looping are two sides of the same coin, and the coin is called iteration. So in this chapter, we will talk about various ways in with which we can make some code run repetitively in our programs. We start by recursion. Recursion is commonly regarded a more advanced topic that is usually taught towards the end of a programming course. So the question is, why did I put it this early in the course? Well, I realized over the last couple of times I taught this course that the less a student knows, the less the student will be confused when recursion is introduced. So let's try it, and I'm pretty sure with the examples in this chapter, recursion can be understood by anyone. Okay, so what is recursion? There is a joke among programmers and computer scientists that goes like this: in order to understand recursion, you must first understand recursion. And this joke already gets to the point of it. Recursion means we are defining something with a reference to itself. Now, back in high school and elementary school, when we were taught how to define a term with some other words, we were taught not to use the term that we are defining in the definition, because otherwise, if a definition is self-referential, we cannot really use it for anything really. However, as programmers, we can do so, and we certainly will, and we will see that this is actually a quite nice approach to implement an iteration logic. So let's start with a very easy example. Imagine you are at a party, at a New Year's Eve party, and it's 10 seconds before the New Year starts. What usually happens is that someone starts a countdown, and then the people start to count down from 10, 9, and so on. And when we hit zero, then the people all scream Happy New Year. Okay, so how would you implement code that does that? And also, how would we parameterize such a code so that we can actually set the number from which the countdown starts? So see here, a countdown function that we define, and it takes one parameter called n, and n is supposed to be an integer, and it's the seconds until the party begins. So what happens if, for example, I want to count down from 3? So the function will be called with n set to 3. What then happens is, in the first line of code, we check if n is equal to 0, and of course it is not. So we go to the else case. And then we print out the number, so we print out 3. And then what happens is the function calls itself. And before doing so, it decrements n by 1. So it calls countdown with an n set to 1. And then the same thing happens again, and of course, n is still not 0, so we hit the else branch again, and we print out 2, and we call the function one more time, and then n is 1. With n being 1, the if branch is still not reached, because it's not 0, so we go into the else branch one more time, we print out 1, and then the function will call itself one more time, now with n being 0. And then finally, when the function is called with n being 0, then what happens? We go into the if branch, we print Happy New Year, and then what happens? Well, nothing happens anymore. Once we hit the print Happy New Year line, this is the last line of code that will actually be executed, because the if statement, of course, continues afterwards, but we see there is no code after the if statement is over. So what happens then? The function countdown, when called with n set to 0, will return, and it will return the value none, the special value that is always returned if we don't provide any explicit return value. And then we see on the screen 3, 2, 1, and Happy New Year. Okay, so I defined the function, and now let's see if the function works. So I call the function with an argument of 3, and I execute it, and indeed, I do see 3, 2, 1, and Happy New Year. So while this is rather, I would say, trivial, let's look at what is going on in the memory. So remember Python Tutor? So here I have 4 tabs with the examples from this chapter. And I copy-pasted the code of some of the examples in the chapter into Python Tutor so that we can now go over the function call in steps. So in the first step, I execute, I click Next. What happens is the function is defined. We see that in memory, as there is a function object created in the object part of the memory. And then in the names part of the memory, we have a global name called countdown, which references the function object. So far, the function has not been called. We only defined it. Now, in the second step, we call countdown with an argument of 3. And now what happens? A function gets called. And as we remember from chapter 2, when the function is called, it gets its own space where it keeps track of the variable names inside it as it runs. So we see here n is set to 3. And now what happens is exactly what I just told you what would happen. We go into the else branch, because the condition of the if branch is not yet fulfilled. We print out n, and then we call countdown again with n being 2. So now let me click further. So we go, we see we hit the hit if, the if line, it will skip, be skipped. We go into the elf branch, and now print n is executed. We see the printed output up here. So we see a 3. And then what happens is the last line of code in the function will be executed, countdown n minus 1. And what happens is, this is of course a function call, another function call. So what happens is, for the second function call, another space in memory, in the names area of the memory, will be reserved for the second function call. And within that, n is set to 2. So note, the important observation here is that the first function call is still there. It has still, the function has not yet returned. In other words, we have two instances of the same function being run at the same time at the moment. Of course, both functions are at a different stage. So the first function call is at its last line. It's actually waiting for the second function call to return so that the first function call can continue. So now let's go on. The second function call is being executed. We hit the else branch again. We print out 2. And then yet another function call with n being 1 is initiated, which leads to another area in our memory where n is set to 1. And remember that the other two function calls, they just don't go away yet because they are still waiting. So the second function call is now waiting for the third function call to finish. And the first function call is waiting for the second function call to finish. So we have a dependency here, right? The first one is waiting for the second one is waiting for the third, and so on. And we do that one more time. So we go into the else branch, we print out 1, and then the countdown function calls itself with n being set to 0. So what happens now? We go into the if branch, and then print Happy New Year, the line will be executed, right? So we will see Happy New Year in the output. And now the fourth function call that is currently going on, where n is 0, is basically in just in the moment before it is finished. And we see that because we see this return value here written. And the return value will be none, and it is none because we didn't specify any explicit return value. So if I click Next now, this function call will now disappear. Because why? Well, the print Happy New Year function is line is the last line that is basically executed, and below that there is no further line of code in the body of the function. So if I hit Next, the scope will go away. And now we go back, we return. So the so Python returns its flow of execution to the countdown function where n was set to 1. And now what does this function call do? Well, it is already in its last line, and the only thing that this function call is doing, it was waiting for the other function call to finish. And now that the other function call is finished, now this function call is also finished because it's also the last line of code. So now the next scope will go away. And so will the other two scopes. And finally, after all the function calls are gone, we are left with an output, 3, 2, 1, Happy New Year. And we are left with only one variable name called countdown, which references the function object. So all the names are now gone. They were local scope. And as we learned in chapter 2, local scope goes away after a function call. by the way, this function is a function that does not have a return value, but it has a side effect. And the side effect is that we print something to the screen. So otherwise, this function would be pointless, because without a return value, why would we ever call a function if there is no output? So the output in this case is a side effect. Okay, that is recursion. So let's reiterate here, what is recursion? Recursion means, to go back to the simple example, we have a function that consists of some if-else logic, or some, let's say, conditional logic. And in some cases, the function calls itself, and in some cases, it doesn't. And this is the structure of a recursion. So recursion is kind of like a recursive definition, something that is defined with, you know, by referring to itself. However, there has to be a way out at the end. If there is no way out, then if there were, for example, a countdown call in the other branch, in the if branch here as well, then this function would keep on calling itself and never stop. And that would be bad. That's not what we want. And we will see an example of infinite recursion later on. So to summarize, a recursion means we have a function which has a conditional logic in it. In some cases, the function calls itself with a modified argument. Otherwise, we wouldn't get to an end. And then we have a case, at least one case, where the function does not call itself. And we call any case where the function does not call itself a base case. So that's why I write here base case. Okay, that's recursion in a trivial example. Let's look at some other examples. My assumption is that all of you know recursion already. And that is why I think I should teach recursion early in the programming course. Why do you know recursion already? Well, you have seen examples in math when you went to high school where recursion was taught. However, most likely, the teacher did not call it recursion back then. So I give you an example. The factorial of a number. So you may remember that the factorial of a number is a concept that is taught usually within the scope of probability theory or statistics. So whenever we want to estimate what is the probability of some event happening, we divide the number of all the cases where the event happens by the number of all the possible events. And oftentimes, when we have to figure out how many possibilities are there to throw, I don't know, a coin, or how many possibilities are there to throw, let's say, six dice or something like that, usually a factorial is involved. So what is a factorial? You remember this definition? The factorial is written as an exclamation mark. So n factorial here, n factorial is the number where is basically the number that gets multiplied by n minus 1 factorial. So you see here already a recursive definition. I give you an example. So what is 3 factorial? 3 factorial is just 3 times 2 times 1. So this would be 6. So the factorial, in other words, in maybe easier terms, is the multiplication of all the numbers, of all the whole numbers, starting from the number for which you want to calculate the factorial down to 1 in decrements of 1. So again, the factorial of 3 is just 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. And of course, because we don't want to have only calculate the factorial for one particular number, but in a general case, we have to formulate the factorial in a generic way. And we do so with this formula. We say n factorial is n times n minus 1 factorial. And then the mathematicians teach you that 0 factorial is defined to be 1. Back in high school, I always wondered, why is this the case? Is this a natural law? Well, at the end of the day, this is just a definition. So this is something that mathematics people defined to be. So they didn't derive it from somewhere. But this definition makes sense. So what can we see here in this definition of the factorial? Well, we can see that, again, we have a recursive definition. So n factorial is defined in terms of a factorial, of another factorial, namely the factorial n minus 1. And we have a base case. So we have a case where the factorial is defined without referencing another factorial. And this is 0 factorial, which is defined to be 1. So base case and the non-base case, also called the recursive case. So let's see how can we translate this simple example from mathematics that you all know into Python code. So here's a function factorial, which takes one parameter n. N is an integer, so we write that in the doc string, of course. And the number returned is also an integer. It's most likely going to be a very big integer because the factorial is a very fast growing function. And then the code begins. And we basically copy-paste the math into code. So here we have the base case. So whenever n is zero, which is here, we compare n to zero, we just return one, because that's the case by definition. And that is the base case, because we don't have to call factorial again. And then in the other case, in the other alternative, what we do is we call the factorial function again, and we decrement the parameter n by one. And whatever we get back, we store in a variable called recurse. And then the actual result that we are interested in is just n times whatever we get back from the factorial function, from the recursive call here. This is the result. And then, of course, we return the result. So what is different here in this example compared to the previous example? Well, here, obviously, we have a return value. And this is usually what you want and what you see, because usually whenever you use a recursion to calculate something, you are interested in some solution to something. You are not interested in a side effect of, let's say, printing out a countdown, but you are interested in some solution to a problem, in this case, a math problem. So we have to return some result from the function. And other than that, not so much is different here. Now, one difficulty, many people in the beginning have a problem by following basically the flow of execution here. So given some n that is not zero, that is greater than zero, the function runs and it will end up in the else branch. And then the beginning student, so to say, reads this line of code. And then what do you do? Do you follow back up again the factorial n minus one, and you go back up and start doing your analysis by reading from top to bottom again? The answer is no. When I see such code, what I do is, when I see a recursive call, I just assume that I get back a correct result for the moment when I read this, and then I assume the recurse result is correct, and then I just go on with my computation. So when I read this code, I just read this line of code, and then I continue to read this line of code. I don't go back and read the code from top to bottom again, because this is, of course, what would happen if I called this function. You know, when I call this function, of course, the flow of execution goes back up. But when I read this code, I don't want to follow the flow of execution. So this is, I just assume that I get back a good return value from this call here. Okay, so let's define this function. Let's see if it works, and then we will look in Python Tutor and what are the underlying details in memory. And then as we look into this function in memory, we will also understand how these functions work when they are being executed. So factorial of 3, this would be just 3 times 2 times 1, which is 6. And the function indeed gives me back 6. Okay, so let's go to Python Tutor again. And see, here I copy-pasted the code of the factorial function here. So I execute the first step. And the function is defined. I have a variable factorial in the global namespace, which references the function object. And then in the second step, I call the function with an argument of 3, and I want to store the result in a variable called solution. So when I call factorial of 3, what happens is, for the new function call, a new area in memory is created where n is set to 3, and this n is only valid as this function is being executed. And then we go from top to bottom, and because n is 3, we end up in the else branch. And then we read this line of code, recurse equals factorial of n minus 1. And when we hit this line of code, what's going to happen? The right-hand side, of course, is evaluated first before the result of the right-hand side can be assigned to the variable on the left-hand side, which is why Once we start executing this line of code, which has the red arrow here, what happens is immediately I will get another area in memory where now n is being set to 2. And this is the second function that is being run at the same time. So now the first function call is waiting for the second function call to finish. And then within the second function call, the code starts to run from top to bottom again. And because n is 2, we end up at the very same line of code again. And we make another function call and set n to n now. So 2 minus 1 is 1. So we have another function call simultaneously going on, where now n is set to 1. And now the second function call is waiting for this third one to finish. So again, just we had in the countdown example before, every function call is now waiting on the subsequent function call to finish. So what happens if factorial of 1 is executed? Well, we hit the else branch one more time. And now the function is called with n being set to 0. And so now the third function here is waiting for the fourth to finish. And now n is 0. So what happens is I hit the return statement. I hit return 1. And we learned in chapter 2 that whenever we hit a return statement, the function is done. It stops. Whatever comes after a return statement will never be executed in this function call, because the return statement finishes the function call and returns whatever value is being evaluated on the right side of or next to the return statement. And it's just 1 here. So what happens here? When I click next, the factorial function where n is 0 is now in the instant where it's basically being finished up. And we see that the return value is going to be 1. So previously, the return value was none because we didn't return anything. Now the return value is 1. And this 1 is now being returned to where? Well, to the function call where n is 1. So this function call where n was set to 1 basically called or created this other function call where n is now 0. So once this function call is done, the return value is given back to the third function call here, the third function call to factorial. And now what does this function call do? It becomes active again. That's what the blue coloring means. That's where, that's the active area in management. And now what happens is factorial of n minus 1 has now returned the number 1. So now at the right-hand side here of this assignment statement is now 1, because that's what we got back. And now we store the 1 in the variable recurse. And then we go on, and then we say result is n times recurse, and n is 1, and recurse is also 1, so result will be 1 times 1, which is also 1. So then we actually return 1 again. So we see result is also 1, and now the return value, because of that, we have return result, so the return value is also 1, and this 1 is now given back to the next function call above, where n was set to 2. And now what does this function call do? Well, it continues. This function call was waiting now for the other function call to finish. Now that the other function call is finished, it continues. It comes back to life. And the right-hand side of this line of code is now done being evaluated. And this will now be 1, because the 1 was previously returned. So recurse is also here now 1. And then the result will now be n times recurse. So it will be 2 times 1. Which means we get a result of 2, and the 2 will then also become the return value. And this 2 will be given up to the function that called this function. And then one more time, the factorial n minus 1 call here returns. And now this it has been evaluated to 2, so recurse is now set to 2. And then the result is n times recurse, which is 3 times 2, which would be 6. That is why result will become 6. And then I return the result, I return 6. And that's the return value now. And now the function is gone. And the solution is now set to 6. OK, so we see already in this easy example here that a lot is going on in memory. And I use Python Tutor here because drawing this in my memory diagram is rather tedious, because I have to, you know, I need lots of space in my memory diagram just to draw 4 function calls. But I think you get the point, and I think Python Tutor is a good visualization in this case. for you to understand what is going on in this function. Okay, let's go on in the presentation. So how can we improve the factorial function? So you remember that in this course, I am also trying to teach to you some of the best practices that you should follow. So what? Let's maybe go back to the version that we were looking at. So what comes to mind when we read this code? Well, when we read this code is we have two branches, obviously, and in both branches we have a return. And I told you the rule, whenever we hit the return statement, the function call is over. So whenever, that means whenever we hit the if branch and go to the return one, everything that is below the return one, which includes the else here, so everything that I mark here, can never be executed, right? Once I hit the return one, everything that is below can never be executed. So in other words, I don't have to use this else here. I don't need this. Instead of this else, I can just get rid of this else. And then, of course, I have to detent I have to detent the code block. And now this code is exactly the same as before. So again, this is the original if-else branch. And if I get rid of the else and detent the code block here, this code is exactly the same as before. It does exactly the same. Of course, it looks a little bit different. I'm saving one word, the else word. But the code does exactly the same. And why again? Because whenever I go into the if branch and whenever I go into the if branch here, I will hit the return statement. And whenever I hit the return statement, the function call is over and whatever happens below will never be executed in this particular function call. So because of that, I do that. And whenever I can do that, I should do that. And there is a name for writing code in this way. This is the so-called early exit pattern. And we call this early exit pattern because when we hit the return, we exit from the function early. Early meaning before the end. And that's just one way to make code look a little bit nicer. Why is this code nicer? Because now I'm conveying another idea as the programmer. I'm conveying the idea that whenever I hit this return one, the function is over. So I know, in other words, when I'm down here, I must not be here in the first place. So in other words, when I read this code top to bottom, I know that, okay, now this part is done. I don't have to worry about this condition again when reading the rest of the function call here, of the function definition. So it's just a little bit nicer. And you will see the idea of the early exit pattern also in some other contexts. And it saves us a little bit of type and makes the code a little bit nicer. And then, of course, going from this formulation here to the one that I'm about to show you is also not so hard. So maybe I do it interactively. So maybe we keep staying here. And what we see here is that the factorial n minus 1 will be stored in the recurse variable. And then I just use the recurse variable in the next line. So how about this? How about I just go ahead and I take this factorial n minus 1 and I copy-paste it to wherever the word recurse was standing, and I just get rid of this here, and I have saved even more lines of code here. So this code is absolutely equivalent. It's actually a bit cheaper because we don't have to use a variable. So we have one, we don't have to set and read one variable in between. So it's a little bit faster, but this is really bogus, actually. So you could, in Python, as we learned, setting and reading variables is very cheap because all variables really are is just references, and that is a very cheap operation. And then, of course, we can do the same here. I calculate here the result. I store it in result, and then next line I return result. So how about this? I just copy paste this code here and get rid of this line, and maybe I also get rid of the space of the empty line in between. And now I have a very compact version of the code. And the funny thing is, if you look above at the mathematical definition, it basically looks the same. So in other words, this is code that gets as close as possible to the actual formulation in math. And that's one of the reasons why many people like Python, because Python is a language that allows for formulating code in a way that looks like math. Okay, and if I now go ahead, this is exactly what you will find here. That's the second version. I will define the function. And then, of course, factorial of 3 is still 6, so it still works. Okay. Let's look at another example. So the trivial example, the countdown, was very simple. And it was, it was basically just to illustrate the point, so that's why it was that simple. And also, I think the factorial example is rather trivial. So I know that if you begin with recursion, it may be hard to understand the first time around. But once you understood recursion, and I think we all have, then this shouldn't be too hard. But now the question is recursion always this intuitive? So is it always similar to something we can express in math? And the answer to that is unfortunately no. There are examples where an algorithm is recursive, but we cannot really intuitively tell what the algorithm does. And one such example is the so-called Euclid's algorithm. Euclid is an old Greek mathematician and philosopher. And he back then, in I think 200 or 300 before Christ, developed an algorithm that can be used to determine the greatest common divisor of two integers. So how did he do that? He saw this. He saw that if I'm given two integers a and b, and I want to calculate the greatest common divisor, all I need to do is, If I need to check if one of them, in this case b, is 0, then I just return a. And if this is not the case, so this is the base case, and then the other case down here is the recursive case. We see that it's the recursive case because the function calls itself. And then he says the recursive case is just we switch a and b. So where we had a before, we now put the b. And where we had b before, we say a modulo divide by b. And this is basically what he came up with. And if you ask me, if I look at this, I don't find this intuitive. There are ways to visualize this algorithm so that you can intuitively understand what it does. But I don't think that this is an intuitive algorithm. However, it works. And it also has another nice side benefit. It's a very efficient algorithm. So let's look at it. How do we check an algorithm that calculates greatest common divisors? So we just generate some test cases, for example, 12 and 4. So we know that for those two numbers, the greatest common divisor should be 4. So it is. So it seems to work. And then this is what I meant with the algorithm is extremely efficient. So I just take two very big numbers. And I try to calculate the greatest common divisor. And it also works. And it seems to be 9. But for the second example here, we cannot really manually verify this. I couldn't do this in my head. For 12 and 4, we could. And then since we're here testing functions, I told you before that, or at least in the exercises, you will see that when you write functions and you want to, you know, test at least for plausibility if your function is correct, you should make sure that you also test so-called edge cases. And what is an edge case when testing two integer numbers for their greatest common divisor? Well, an edge case would be to just use two prime numbers, because we know from high school that a prime number is any number above 1 that is only divisible by 1 and itself. So any two prime numbers, they won't have a greatest common divisor. Or in other words, the greatest common divisor of any two prime numbers will always be 1. So let's look at the example. So I chose 7, which we know is a prime number, and 7,919. 7,919 is the 1,000th prime number. So that's why I chose it. I looked it up in a table. You don't know this by heart, of course. And if you check it, we get back 1, and that means the algorithm seems to be good. So at least it works in edge cases. Okay, let's look at some other example, which is a typical example of a recursion. the so-called Fibonacci numbers. And also, as a precursor, I will already say that whenever you will solve Fibonacci numbers, you will not use a recursion in practice. So Fibonacci numbers are efficiently solved with another approach, and we will see this other approach at the end of this lecture. So here I will show you a recursive version of Fibonacci numbers for illustration purposes, to illustrate some other points that we have not seen before, and also to expose you to the idea of exponential growth. So what are Fibonacci numbers? So Fibonacci numbers, I will give you the example here on the paper. So we define the first Fibonacci number as 0. And then we define the second Fibonacci number as 1. In some other versions, you will see that the first Fibonacci number is 1 and the second Fibonacci number is 2. However, you can also start with 0 and 1. Now, the important thing is those two numbers are Fibonacci numbers by definition. So this is not a natural law or something. This is just what we define. And then we have one rule as to how to calculate Fibonacci numbers. And this will be the next number in line will always be the sum of the previous two. So 0 plus 1 is 1. And then we have 1 plus 1, and this will be 2. 1 plus 2 will be 3. 2 plus, plus 3 will be 5. 3 plus 5 will be 8. And 5 plus 8 will be 13, hopefully. Yeah, sometimes I write the European style of a 1, or sometimes the American style. So let's maybe do the European style here. So the ones would look like this. That's okay. Okay. Let's go on. So what do we see here? We see that we can calculate the Fibonacci numbers from left to right. Why can we see that? Well, that's how I just defined the Fibonacci numbers to be. I said the first two numbers are given, and then we just add up always two numbers to get the next one. However, we can also read this this series of numbers from the right-hand side going to the left. So I can say the 13 here is the same as 5 plus 8. In other words, in order to get this one, I need to know this one and this one. Okay? And then in order to know, in order to calculate the 8, what I need is I need the 5 and I need the 3. In order to get the 5, I need the 3 and I need the 2. So always the two predecessors. But the important point is when I'm going from the right hand side and I'm asking the question, what is this Fibonacci number? Let's say I don't know it. How do I answer this question? Well, all I need to answer this question is those two numbers. So I can look at this from a recursive way, so to say. So I can ask the question, what is this number? Well, this number is this number plus this one. So I have to figure out the numbers from the right to the left. So in other words, whatever the pattern is going from the left to right, which means we always add two numbers to get the next one, there is also a pattern, so to say, from the right-hand side, which just means whenever we have a certain number, we just have to know what are the two predecessors in order to get it. So let's see how we can use this observation in code to code up the Fibonacci numbers. So here we see also the Fibonacci numbers going a little bit further until 144. 144 will be the 13th Fibonacci number, and this will have an index of 12. So note for what is to come, these are the Fibonacci numbers, and I will index them in the same way as we index in Python. So the first Fibonacci number will have the index 0, the second Fibonacci number will have the index 1, and then 144, this is, as I said, the 13th Fibonacci number, and this will have an index of 12. So just to make sure that you don't make any off by one errors here. And let's write code, recursive code, to calculate a Fibonacci number. So here is the function Fibonacci. It takes I now, not n, and I is supposed to be an integer, and the integer is the index of the Fibonacci number to calculate. So it's an index, so it's a zero-based index. And then the function returns the ith Fibonacci number, which of course is also an integer. So let's look at what the code does here. Let's say I want to go ahead and maybe I also write the indices here. Maybe this is index 1, index 0, 1, this is index 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, and 7. So for American viewers, this is how we write a 7 in Europe. We have this dash here. You don't do that in the USA. For you, I think this would be a 7 or close to a 7 at least. But so anyways, so let's say I want to calculate the 13 here, which happens to be the Fibonacci number with the index 7. So this is the 8th Fibonacci number, and it has an index 7. This is now what I want to calculate. In this example, I would be set to 7. So let's run the code in our head. What would happen if I were to calculate this Fibonacci number? Well, if I is 7, then the first case here is not reached. Then there is an elif, and the elif seems to be the second Fibonacci number, and 7 is also not equal to 1. So we go back to the last case here. And this is obviously a recursion. Why is this a recursion? Well, because the function calls itself here. Now the question is, what is different to the previous examples we saw of the greatest common divisor and the factorial? Well, the big difference is we have now two recursive calls. So Fibonacci number, the Fibonacci function, calls itself two more times. That's a difference. Another difference is, as we see, we have two base cases. However, having two base cases in this example is also rather trivial. Why? Well, if I told you that the Fibonacci numbers are defined to be, you know, the first two Fibonacci numbers are this by definition, and then only the third Fibonacci we start to calculate, this means there have to be two base cases, right? So factorial of 0 was 1, so there was only one base case for the factorial function, but here we define the first numbers, and that's why we have two base cases here. So, but again, this is obviously a recursion. And as I already told you, this recursion will not be very efficient, but it works correctly. So let's see what this code does. I define the Fibonacci function, and now we call it. I call it with an index 12 to calculate the 13th Fibonacci number. So the 13th Fibonacci number will be 144. So let's execute this code, sir, and we get back a 144. So in other words, even if we don't understand every bit of this code, the function seems to work. It seems to be, you know, correct. However, and this is a topic that will become important in the long run, not for a beginner in programming, but I already want to expose you to it. Let's talk a little bit about how efficient an algorithm is, or what is efficiency in the first place for an algorithm. So what I have here is a double percent here, and this is what in Jupyter Notebook is called a magic. And this magic is named the time it magic. And what the time it magic does is whenever you put this in the beginning of a code cell, the code cell is timed. That's what it does. And then I have a dash N100 here. And what does the dash N100 do? Well, that means when I now execute this code cell, Jupyter Notebook will execute this code cell exactly 100 times and time it 100 times. And then it will give me the average runtime of this code cell and a standard deviation. So let's run this. And I get back 82.1. And what is this? This is microseconds. So this means the function ran very fast. Micro is 10 times 10 to the negative 6. So it's a 0 dot, and then we have 5 zeros, and then a 1. This would be a microsecond. And here we take 82 microseconds. So it's a very fast function, obviously. And here we can read that we had 100 trials here. So now regarding what is the efficiency of an algorithm. Well, what do we mean by efficiency in the first place? Well, there are two big topics when we talk about efficiency of an algorithm. The first one is its runtime. So how fast is the algorithm? And the second big thing is how much space in memory does the algorithm need? So what we do here is, in this chapter here, we only look at the runtime. So we time it. That's why I use the time it magic. And let's see what happens if I try to calculate Fibonacci for the index 24, which means I calculate now the 25th Fibonacci number. And I run the same code, except that now 12 becomes 24. And we see already the star in the cell here, that the code cell is still running. So what is this? And now the question is, how long do we have to wait to see a result? Now we see the result. So this cell was also executed 100 times. And on average, the runtime was 18.6 milliseconds. So a millisecond is 10 times 10 to the negative 3 seconds. So it's 0.001 seconds. That's what a millisecond is. So in other words, 1 millisecond is 1,000 times longer than a microsecond. In other words, if I disregard the 82 and the 18, and we only look at the prefix of the second here, on average, calling Fibonacci 24 takes 1,000 times as much time as calling Fibonacci of 12. And that's an observation. So what we did, going from 12 to 24, is we, so to say, doubled the input of the function, and the runtime grew by 1,000. So that's a very bad trade-off here. So doubling the input leading to 1,000 times slower runtime. And that's an example of so-called exponential growth that is occurring here. That is basically slowing down the algorithm. And I think I have one more example here. Yes, Fibonacci of 36. And as we can already see, the dash n only has one. So I will only execute this code cell once and time it with that. And we see that this also takes time. It takes very long time. And now you understand why I didn't call this cell 100 times. So now this cell took 6 seconds. OK, that means going from 24 to 36 means we have another factor of round about 1,000 the function call is 1,000 times slower again. In other words, going from the first cell Fibonacci of 12 to the last cell of Fibonacci of 36, the function will be 1 million times slower. And what happened to the input? The input only tripled from 12 to 36. So this is, again, to just show a very bad runtime. So we want to know, why is this runtime so bad? And how do we do that? We look at the Fibonacci function in Python Tutor to understand what is going on in memory. So let's go ahead. We create the Fibonacci number. Now we call it for an index of 5. This is a problem that is significantly smaller than Fibonacci of 12. But it's already big enough so that we will see what's going on, why something goes bad here. So we call Fibonacci. The first time around, a new local scope appears. I is set to 5. And the function goes. It skips the if. It skips the elif. And then it hits the return statement here. This is the last line. And then in this last line, the Fibonacci function will call itself 2 more times. So what will happen is, Fibonacci will stop here on the left Fibonacci call. So when the expression that is next to the return statement is evaluated, this expression is evaluated from left to right, of course. So the Fibonacci I minus 1 is called first. And whenever this has returned, then only Fibonacci of I minus 2 will be evaluated. So in other words, we will now see this function call here. And this function call will be Fibonacci of 4. So let's click Next a couple of times. And now we see, as I said, the function is called again. And we have a new local scope. And I is now 4. So what does this function call do? Well, it runs again via if, via elif, and then it hits the last line again. And also here, the left Fibonacci call will be evaluated first, and only once this is done, the right-hand side will be evaluated. So what happens now is I is 4, so another Fibonacci call will appear where I is set to 3. Okay, so let's look at the memory diagram. We have the first function call, Fibonacci with I being 5, and this function is waiting for the Fibonacci call where I is 4, and this function call is waiting for the function call where I is 3. However, those upper two function calls, they are also not yet done, even if this call returned. Why is that? Well, the Fibonacci where I is 4 is not only waiting for this function call, but it also will have to go ahead and calculate Fibonacci with I is set to 2. And the upper function call here, where I is set to 5, once the Fibonacci where I is 4 returns to it, this function call also has to make yet another function call where I is set to 3. And now we see already the problem. So the Fibonacci call where I is 5 will make another call to Fibonacci with I set to 3 eventually, sometime in the future. However, we have a Fibonacci call to with I set to 3 already going on. In other words, there are many, many problems that are solved again and again and again. So, and we can also read this in the source code already. So, in other words, for every time we call the Fibonacci function, two more calls will be made. So, if I call Fibonacci once, this leads to two more calls. And those two more calls, they will lead to four more calls. And those four more calls, they will lead to eight more calls. And those eight more calls will lead to 16 more calls. So, in other words, every time for every I, so to say, we have the number of function call will double. So this is exponential growth, right? Going from 1 to 2, from 2 to 4, from 4 to 8, from 8 to 16, from 16 to 32, and so on. So we have exponential growth in the number of function calls. Okay. So let's run through this rather quickly now. And then I will draw you another diagram where we will look at this from a different angle. So now Fibonacci I with 3 is running. This creates another call where I is 2. This creates another call where I is 1. And now I is set to 1. Well, this is a base case, right? So this function will not make another function call. This will now go away right away. So now we see the return value. So the base case is hit, and this will return. And now the Fibonacci call where I is 2 will make the second function call on the right-hand side now, where I is set to 0. This is luckily also a base case, so this will immediately return. So it's called, and it will immediately return. And then this call here, where I is set to 2, will also return, because now this call has evaluated both the left-hand Fibonacci call, Fibonacci I minus 1, but also the right Fibonacci call, Fibonacci I minus 2. Now this call, all it has to do is add the two up and then pass it one up. So now what we see is we have a sequence here of function calls, and it grew down, and it now goes back up. And then we will see that the sequence will go down again. So in a way, these function calls, they will now go up and down and up and down, and now down again, and now back up. And now the function is done. So we see that we have way too many functions calls. We are making the same function calls over and over again. So this is what happens in memory. And now, as I said, I will give you another diagram that will show you what happened. So let's say I will call here. Get this out of the way. So let's say I make a function call and set I to 5. And I abbreviate this just as f of 5. So what does this do? Well, if I go back in the source code, what this will do is this will skip the two base cases and go to the last line. And then this will lead to another function call, which is f of I minus 1. So this will lead to another function call f of 4. However, that's not the only function call that has to be done. This will also lead to another function call 5 minus 2, so 3. So the f, in order to calculate Fibonacci of 5, f of 5 here, I have to calculate Fibonacci of 4, f of 4, and also Fibonacci of 3. And only if I get back the values for both of the function calls, I can add together the results. So this result will be added to this one, and then I only know what is the result, what is the overall result here. And now the problem is this. In order to calculate f of 4, what we need to do, we need to calculate f of 3 and f of 2. And we see the problem here in another angle. So in order to calculate f of 3, or let's say we calculate f of 3 here, but we also calculate f of 3 here. So in other words, we have a redundancy here. And now what happens is, in order to calculate this f of 3, I have to calculate f of 2 and f of 1. And luckily, f of 1 is a base case, f of 2 is not. So this will lead to some more function calls, namely f of 1 and f of 0. Maybe put this in the picture. And then this one is the base case. And here, this f2 will lead to function calls f of 1 and f of 0. And then these are all the base cases. And on the right-hand side, we will have the same. We will have, this will create a function call f2 and f of 1. And the f of 2 will create two more function calls, f of 1 and f of 0. So this is just another way to visualize to you what a call to the Fibonacci function with I of 5 means. And now let's see how much redundant work do we do. So on the right-hand side, right here, this is now a tree. In computer science, we would call this a tree. And in order to, and let's analyze this. So we have here this path here, the f of 3 path, and we also have this path here. In other words, once I have calculated this one here, I already know that I can reuse it. In other words, let's use another color. All of this work here is unnecessary. The entire half, the entire right half of the tree is unnecessary. And then let's analyze, do the same analysis on the left-hand side of the tree. So the f of 4, I don't see anywhere else. The f of 3, do I see it anywhere else? No. Here the f of 2 and this f of 2, I see them again. So I can actually get rid of this computation graph here, or this part of the computation. This is unnecessary. And then here's the question is, do I see any more f calls that have been made? Well, here I have an f call to 1 with f of 1 call, and here I have another f1, so I can also get rid of this f1. And so what I'm left with is just the numbers, the Fibonacci numbers, basically in sequence. I have the 0, the first Fibonacci number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So in other words, if I calculate the Fibonacci numbers from left to right, so from as we actually defined them, let's calculate the Fibonacci number from left to right, then what this means in the tree is all I need to do is I need to calculate this first. So this is my first calculation. This is my second calculation, my third calculation, my fourth calculation, my fifth calculation, and then this would be my last calculation here. In other words, if I go this direction, in other words, graphically speaking, I calculate the Fibonacci numbers from left to right, then I won't run into this problem. But we see, so what's the learning of this? So we see that the Fibonacci numbers, they are defined in a forward way from left to right, but we can solve the problem in a backward way. So again, in order to get this, the 13, all I need to know is what are these two numbers. So I can go, I can have a backward path in calculating this. However, as we see in this graph already, every number has two predecessors, and they unfortunately overlap. So this is why we do all the wasteful work here. And then if I use the other representation in this graph here, in this tree structure here, then I think it is absolutely evident what is the big problem here. We're doing repetitive work. And in this case, in the Fibonacci case, the solution is we just calculate the Fibonacci numbers from left to right, and we will see at the end of this lecture how we will do that. But the learning is we could do that in a recursive way, and in a future chapter, in chapter 8 to be precise, we will see a way how we can calculate the Fibonacci numbers from right to left, from back to from in a backwards way, without the extra work. And how can we do that? We can already see the point. So the problem was is that we did not remember here in the tree that we did some calculation before. So once I have done this calculation, F3 here, how about this? How about I take the return value of this function and I write it somewhere in a lookup table, and whenever I get to the right side of the tree, I just look up the value. And this is a concept called memoization. And it's part of something that is called dynamic programming, a discipline called dynamic programming. And there are problems that can only be solved in a recursion. There is no forward solution to it, or at least no good one, no obvious one. And with this additional tool that we will learn in chapter 8, we can actually solve problems in a backward fashion. So in this chapter, in chapter 4 here, the idea, I present recursion to you as a way to iterate, but I also present it to you, and that's the second meaning of recursion, in a way to view a problem in a backwards fashion, because there will be problems in the future that we can only solve in a backwards fashion. And then we have to develop more tools that we will implement in Python that will allow us to make the backward calculation efficient. And again, this is called dynamic programming. And dynamic programming is often used in logistics and supply chain management to solve optimization problems. And also there are some applications generally in economics. And also most notably, if you are into finance and if you are into option valuation, then learning about dynamic programming and recursion is just a very basic idea within dynamic programming is also valuable, because in order to evaluate a stock market option, for example, you also do that in a backward fashion if you take finance courses, and then you will learn that. And in order to implement what you learn in finance courses on option theory, you can use dynamic programming, which means at the end of the day, you construct such a tree and you go it backwards. So the takeaway is to look at the code here. What do we learn here? Well, recursion means we can also have more than one base case. And recursion also means that we can make more than one recursive call. However, this is often not efficient. Okay. So, and in this context, we also discussed efficiency of algorithms. And I gave you just a high-level introduction into what it means to talk about the efficiency, the runtime analysis of an algorithm. Okay, let's look now at some other case. Let's look at infinite recursion. And infinite recursion is something bad. So I will just try to make you aware of that. So what's an example of an infinite recursion? So a function, like here, run forever, that all it does is it calls itself, run forever. And as you can tell by the name, this function will call itself forever. Now, the question is this function useful? And the answer is, of course, in this case, no. This is just a trivial example of showing to you what is an infinite recursion. But infinite recursions will occur when you misprogram a recursive solution to a problem. So it could happen. And it could also happen, as we shall see soon, in some other circumstances that you did not plan ahead. So let's first run this function forever. And now one of two things will happen. Either my computer will die and this recording is over because the function will run forever. And so my computer just runs out of computational power, out of CPU. Or the second thing that will happen is Python may save me. Let's look at what happens. The function keeps on running. We see the star here. And then eventually I get what Python tells me is a recursion error. So Python saves me here. Python has a built-in detection for infinite recursions. So if ever you run into a infinite recursion, then Python will basically break out of the infinite recursion and throw a so-called recursion error. And yeah, that's what we see here. Luckily, otherwise the presentation would be over by now. So how can we get into an infinite recursion if I don't give you a toy example? Let's look at our countdown example again. And remember, this function was defined for integers. So just as a short reminder, before I execute this example, if you are unsure what the function takes, you can always use Python's built-in help function. And now you can read the doc string of our countdown function right here. And it says the arguments should be n and supposedly an integer. But now let's assume that we, as the user of this function, did not read the doc string. And we call this function, let's say, with a float. And let's maybe not call it with 3.1, but let's call it with just 3.0. What happens? Well, what happens is the function spits out 3.0, 2.0, 1.0, and Happy New Year. So the function luckily works. But let's go back to the example as it was set up. Let's call the function with 3.1. And what happens now? Now something weird happens. It starts to count down from 3.1, 2.1, 1.1, and then it hits 0.10000 and a 9. And then it passes the 0. And then the fourth number will be negative 0.89999. And then it goes on with negative 0.9s. So two things that we observe. First, by giving the function a number whose value is not a whole number, not an integer, it will not hit the 0. So the countdown won't fire off, that we don't hit the Happy New Year. And also observe that the numbers, the floating point numbers here, 0.100 and minus negative 0.8999, they are not precise. And this is also a precursor for what is to come in chapter 5, where we look in detail into numbers and how they work in memory. And you will learn most notably that you cannot expect floating point numbers to be precise. And this is an example here. But here within this chapter, the more important observation that we make is that we messed up the function in the way we called it. We called the function with 3.1 and it didn't work because the function, you know, didn't hit its base case. And because the countdown function did not hit its base case, it ran forever. And then also observe, as I showed you before, if I ran the function with 3.0, luckily it works. So let me use this as a chance to tell you about an idea called duck typing. So what is duck typing? So in many programming languages, when you specify a function, when you define a function, you have to explicitly specify what the type of the argument will be. So in the definition, you will say this parameter is an integer, this parameter is a float. And then at runtime, the programming language will enforce this. So in many other programming languages, when you say the countdown function takes an integer, then we are not allowed to pass in a float. We would see an error here. However, in Python, Python is a little bit more easygoing here. Python accepts any object as the argument, even though we expect here in the function clearly an integer, but we can technically pass in any object we want. And then as long as the object that we pass in behaves like an integer, the function can work with it. And the float 3.0 obviously behaves like an integer. And whenever some object of a different type behaves like an object of a certain type that we are looking at, that we want, then we call this duck typing, or that's an example of duck typing. And why is it called duck typing? Well, the saying among programmers goes, if it walks like a duck and quacks like a duck, it must be a duck. So this saying basically emphasizes that in Python, the behavior of an object is a lot more important than its type. And we will get into this in a lot more detail. This is one of the reasons why I like to talk about abstract concepts in this course, such as we saw in chapter 2. We had I introduced the abstract concept of a callable, and I told you that there are three examples of a callable, namely built-in functions, built-in constructors, but also user-defined functions. And the abstract concept is, you know, anything, any object that is callable is called a callable. And in the same way, as I classified those three examples into one concept, we will classify many, many more types into concepts. And we will already start later in this chapter, actually. But the idea is that the types themselves, they are not that important. It's more like the more important thing is how objects behave. And in this example, the integer 3 and the float 3.0, they behave in the same way, which is why the function works. However, if we are not careful and enter a float with a decimal here, then obviously we get an error message here. And then the question is, what happens when I scroll down here? How far does it go? Well, the output is cut out here. We see the code here wanted to print out 10,500 characters, but only 500 are shown. I have a plugin here that cuts the output just for obvious reasons for in the presentation, but then we still see the recursion error. So it's the same error that we saw before in the countdown example, or in the run forever example. Excuse me. So let's look at some other function. Let's look at the factorial function. And let's call this function with 3.1. What happens? Well, the factorial function will also run into a recursion error. And why do the factorial function and the countdown function run into this recursion error? Well, the base case, in the base case, we checked if n equals 0. And by doing that, we basically require the, only hit the base case if the n is exactly 0. And in this case, if we decrement a number that is not equal to a whole number, in this case 3.1, in increments of 1, we will never hit 0. We can mathematically prove that we won't hit 0. And because we don't hit 0, this doesn't work. How could we improve the number, the functions? Well, we could improve the function in a way where we say, well, as long as, in a way that we modify the base case such that we check if n is smaller than or equal to 0. So in this scenario, once the function, once n is below 0, then the function would also stop. But nevertheless, the output would be wrong. So passing in a floating point number is simply wrong for countdown because it doesn't make sense to print out 3.0 and so on. Okay, so how can we work on the function? How can we improve the functions so that they don't run into a recursion error? Well, we do that by checking the type of the argument passed in and validating the input that a user of our function passes in. So here's a new version of the factorial function. It still takes an n. And now we have some more code up here, two more branches in the if statement. And the first branch says, if not, is instance n int. So what this means is, is instance is a built-in function that takes two arguments. The first argument can be any object, like n. And the second argument is what we refer to in chapter 2 as constructors. And you remember that the type of a constructor is type. In other words, int is a type, it's a data type. So in other words, is instance takes two arguments. The first one is any object, and the second one is any type. And then the function returns true if indeed the object that we passed in is of this type. And it returns false if this is not the case. So in this case, in other words, if the user passes in an integer or an n that is not an integer, that's the not here, then we run into this branch here. And what then happens is we read raise type error. And the raise is another statement which basically raises an exception, which is basically which basically means Python shows us an error message. And then in this case, I use the type error, because whenever a user passes in something into the factorial function that is not of type integer, then it's just the wrong type. So it makes sense to call this a type error. And then I have a custom error message, which says the factorial is only defined for integers. Okay, and then I have this elif branch here, and here I check. So what I know, first of all, what do I know here for the highlighted code here? I know that in this area, n is definitely an integer. So if it's not an integer, we stop here. The race statement, of course, aborts the function, right? It's kind of like the return. The return breaks out of the function and returns from it, and the race statement throws an exception, so the function stops running. In other words, once we are down here, we know for sure that n must be an integer. And then because n is an integer, I can use relational operators. And in this case, check if n is positive or not. And if n is smaller than 0, I raise a value error, because the value of the integer is wrong. It's negative. And in order to calculate a factorial, I must have a positive number. So I provide a custom error message and say the factorial is not defined for negative numbers. So these two branches, they implement, first of all, type checking here. And the elif branch implements input validation. So first we check if the type is correct, and then we check if the object that is of a correct type also is of a correct value for the function to work. And then the third elif, the third condition here, this elif n double equals 0, this is just the old base case. So before, in the old implementation, we had this. It said if, and so on. This code would also work, but whenever we have an if elif here and we have an if here, it may be applicable to just connect the two into one big statement, into one big compound if statement. But the other implementation would also work. So in other words, if we are down here, we just run the function as before. But now we know for sure that n is both an integer and it's positive, or at least non-negative. And if we know that, then we know for sure that we can calculate the factorial. Okay, so now what I do is I define this function and it's tested. So let's check what is the factorial of 0, because 0 is, of course, an edge case when testing the function. So now we get back a 1. If I calculate the factorial of 3, it's still 6. And now if I calculate the factorial of 3.1, I get back a type error. And the function complains and says factorial is only defined for integers. And if I call the factorial with a negative integer, I get a value error, because the factorial is only defined for non-negative numbers. Let me go back to the type error and reiterate some point here that regards the duck typing that I mentioned. So if I use, let's say, 3.0, and I execute the cell again, you will see that, of course, we also get a type error. And that makes sense. Why does it make sense? Well, because I just allow int types. But now what this function unfortunately does, it does not give me as the user of the function the flexibility to pass in a float object that basically behaves like an integer. So duck typing is now obviously disabled. In other words, passing in 3.0, you know, should work, because the value of 3.0, at least for us humans, would be 3, and the factorial of the number 3 should be defined. So now the flexibility that many Python functions allow is not there anymore. I have to pass in an int. And so even though the 3.0 here walks and quacks like 3, it doesn't work. And if you want to become really good in Python programming, then you should always have in the back of your mind duck typing. And you should always assume that whoever uses your code, and that could be yourself, of course, should be allowed to flexibly choose what type of object they pass in. And as long as the object behaves in a correct way, we want to allow that. And here we clearly don't allow that. So For now, we leave it with that. In chapter 5, towards the end, we will talk about abstract base classes, and there is a concept called goose typing. Goose typing is related to duck typing, and goose typing will help us allow to refactor this function into a way so that we can also call it. So in chapter 5, we will see how we can change the factorial function such that I can call it with an integer 3 and a float 3.0, and I get the same result 6 in both cases. And whenever I call the function, even in chapter 5, with, let's say, a factorial of 3.1, I also will get a type error in chapter 5, because the factorial does not make sense if the decimal is not all zeros. Okay. That was the first side of the coin. That was a recursion. So I think the examples here were easy enough to follow. You know, you now know what is recursion. And I just reiterate this. A recursion means usually that we view a problem from its end and we try to solve the problem in a backwards way, so to say. And now we do the opposite. We will solve a problem in a forward way. And in this course, I will call this approach looping. And both recursion and looping, they are again two sides of the same coin, and the coin is iteration. And iteration just means we run some code repetitively. Okay, so we will start with the while statement. You know from chapter 1 already, from our very first example in this course, that we can loop with the for statement. But the for statement, I haven't officially introduced yet in this course. So I've only shown to you an example of how it works, but we haven't formally introduced it here, and we haven't really talked about how the for statement works. And really, we don't need the for statement. We can get away with the while statement all alone. And we will see how the for statement is just a special case of the while statement. So let's start with the while statement. What is it? To show it to you, let's look at the countdown example again. And now, instead of a recursion, we use looping to solve the problem. Here is code. Here is the countdown function again. It still takes an integer n. And now I also included type checking here and input validation, just so that you see more examples of how to do that. And then the actual looping occurs down here. So the code up here, I can actually remove. This is code that only is like making sure that the function is called with good arguments, but the actual business logic is happening in the code that you see as of now. But of course, I will just leave it in the actual version. So let's analyze the while statement. What is the while statement? Well, the while statement is a compound statement, just like the if statement, meaning it consists of a header line. A header line means we have a keyword, while in this case. Just as in the if statement, we have a condition, and then we end the line, the header line, with a colon. And then we also have a body that is executed repetitively, and the body is also indented by four spaces. And that's it. And then once we stop indenting code, so this print Happy New Year is not indented anymore, this is already outside the while loop. And I call this the while loop sometimes because it's basically what this does. So let's assume we call countdown with n set to 3, and we hit the while statement. So what happens? Well, what happens is this condition here, n not equal to 0, is evaluated. And if n is 3, then the condition is true. So 3 is not equal to 0, so this returns true. And then whenever, the rule is this, whenever the condition is true, what happens is we execute the code in the code block. So that means because n is not equal to 0, we go to the print here, we print out 3, and then what we do at the end of the loop, we take n, which is 3, and decrement it by 1. So n will be 2 after that. And then what happens at the end of a while loop is the code, the flow of execution, just goes back up to the while statement, to the header line, And then with our new n, which is now 2, we evaluate the condition again. And now 2 is not equal to 0 is also true. So we will run the code block here one more time, print out 2, decrement the 2, n is now 1. And then we go back up to the header line, compare 1 to 0. It is still not equal to 0. So we will go through the loop one more time, print out 1, and now decrement 1 by 1, so to reach n of 0. And then we go back to the condition. Once we hit the last line of a while loop, we always go back up to the header line. And now we evaluate the condition again. And now n is 0. And then I compare 0 to 0, and it's, of course, the same. And because of that, the condition is false here. And whenever the condition is false, what happens? The while loop stops, and we continue with the flow of execution below the while. So the next line of code that will be executed is just print Happy New Year. So again, the n comes in, it passes the input validation and the input checking, it hits the while loop, and it loops. That's where the loop comes from. It loops around here. It repeats this code a couple of times until the condition here is false. And once this condition is false, we continue with the flow of execution below. So let's define this function and hit and call the countdown function again with 3, and it works. Now, just to show you something, we go to Python Tutor one last time in this chapter. And let's look at it's the exact same example here, of course, just without the doc string. And let's see what happens in memory. So the first step creates the countdown name referencing this function. And then the function will be started. And now we get a new local scope here. And n is set to 3. And then we will pass the input validation and the input and the type checking here. And then we will hit the while loop. And then let's see what happens. So we pass the validation. And now we hit the while loop. And now the condition is evaluated and is, of course, true. Because of that, we hit the next line, which is print n. And we execute this line, and we see the 3 output. And then we will decrement the n by 1. And then n is 2. And then the condition will be evaluated again. It's still true, and so on. So now the code is executed again. N becomes 1. And then one more time, the condition is evaluated. And then we print out a 1. And then n gets decremented one more time to be 0. And then important, now we go back up again, and we evaluate the condition again. But now the condition is false. And because of that, we jump to the print Happy New Year. And we print Happy New Year. And then the function is done, which we see with the return value here. And because there is no return statement here, the return value is again set to 0, and the function returns, and the scope goes away. However, note one big difference to a recursion. Let's go to the very beginning and go over it rather quickly. We only have one function call going on in memory at the same time, and the n is actually updated. So it's 3. And it becomes 2, it becomes 1, it becomes 0, and then the function is done. In the recursive version, what we had is we had different function calls. So the countdown with n equals 3 function call will call countdown with n set to 2. So I have several function calls. I had several function calls here in memory, several scopes, all with the same name. So what we take from that is that an iterative or a looping implementation of the countdown function, and this holds for other algorithms as well, is often a lot more memory efficient because we only need one scope and one name, and that's just a lot more memory efficient. And this is something that holds general for recursion versus looping. And this is why if you go to platforms like Stack Overflow and ask the question, what is better, recursion or looping? Many people will say, well, looping is better because it's more memory efficient. That is why. However, just a note, if you do this kind of research, you will definitely run into people that will tell you, please use a so-called functional language. And or that follows the functional paradigm and not the object-oriented paradigm. And in these other languages, doing recursion does not incur this cost in memory. So there are other programming languages that can actually work with recursion in an efficient way. Python is not one of them. So in other words, whenever you want to write an algorithm to solve a problem at production scale, at a big scale, then most likely a implementation with a while loop or a for loop later on will be better than with a recursion. But for a beginner's problem, it is still important to learn about recursion because there will be problems in supply chain management, for example, that can easily be solved or rather easily be solved with dynamic programming going backwards, so with a recursion, and that are not so easy to solve in a forward way. And because of that, you definitely should know about recursion because, again, many supply chain problems can be solved with it. It's an important concept, even though in Python it is not as memory efficient as a while loop. Okay, let's continue. So let's look at the other examples that we saw before as a recursion. Now we look at them with a loop. And whenever we have a recursion, we call an algorithm a recursive formulation of a problem. And whenever I use a loop, a while loop, or later on a for loop to solve or to implement an algorithm, you will hear me say that is an iterative version of an algorithm. So now we look at an iterative version of Euclid's algorithm. And what do we see here? Well, after the type checking and the input validation, we have here a while loop. And you remember that Euclid's algorithm calculates the greatest common divisor of two numbers A and B. And then the algorithm goes like this. As long as A is not equal to B, we subtract the smaller of the two numbers from the bigger one. So if A is larger than B, we subtract B from A. Otherwise, we subtract A from B. And then the solution to that, after this while loop is over, so after both A and B are the same number, then we just return A. But we could just as well return B down here because once the while loop is over, we know that A and B are the same value. So that's the iterative implementation of Euclid's algorithm. And now back in the recursive version, I told you that I have a hard time to see how this algorithm intuitively works, because back then it had a modulo operator in it and it was just not as intuitive to follow. I personally also have troubles to see how this algorithm works, even though if you check the Wikipedia page for this algorithm, there is a nice visualization, and I think you can follow this. So this algorithm, if you study a little bit, you can intuitively understand, but you couldn't understand it with some other help here. So why did I put this example in the presentation? Well, usually, after like the first couple of times I gave this course, some students asked, so is it true that the iterative version is always easier to formulate, or is it also often the case that the iterative version is better than the recursive version because of the limitations that I just mentioned, the memory limitations? And I know that this is not the case. So in some situations, the recursive formulation is actually really better than the iterative implementation. And Euclid's algorithm is one such example. So let's look at the test cases we saw before. Let's calculate the greatest common divisor of 12 and 4. This is still going to be 4. And then let's go ahead and test the edge case of two prime numbers. So this should be 1, and it is 1. And now we continue the study of efficiency of algorithms. Now we calculate the greatest common divisors of those two large numbers. And if you go back in the presentation, you will see that I calculated the greatest common divisor of exactly these two numbers before with the recursive implementation, and it was super fast, remember? So this algorithm did not take too long. And now if I run the iterative version of the algorithm, we will see that now this takes some time, and it takes very much time, actually. So it's over 7 seconds to find the greatest common divisor. So this is an example where the recursive formulation of the algorithm is actually faster than the iterative version. So this will answer the questions that you may have after this lecture Is the iterative version always better? And the answer is, of course, it depends, and of course, it's not in, and it's not true in general. So just as we had infinite recursions, we can also run into an infinite loop. And usually, you run into an infinite loop if whatever condition that you put into the header line of the while statement is somehow wrong. And we usually call this an off by one error. And this is usually the programmer's fault. You have like a bad implementation, and because of that, your code will run in an infinite loop. However, there are also cases where we don't know if an algorithm will ever return or finish. For example, there is a game which in math goes by the name Collard's conjecture. So that means we will see now a game. Let me just introduce the game so that you know what I'm talking about. So let's play the following game. You will think of a positive integer n, can be any number. And then I give you the rule. If n is even, then you go ahead and you just divide n to get the next number. If n is odd, you multiply the old number by 3 and just add 1 to get the next number. And you repeat these two steps so long as you reach the number 1. And then the question is, do you always reach the number 1? And mathematicians tried to prove this, and still to this day, there is no proof for this. So just this simple game cannot be shown if it always gets to 1 or not. So let's implement this game in Python. So it's a little bit longer, but the reason for that is because I wrote a nice doc string here so that if you copy-paste the solution, this function is basically ready to go for the game. We have input, we have type checking, we have input validation, so n must be strictly positive. And then here is the formulation of the game. That's the important part. So what is the condition in the while loop? Well, the condition is n not equal to 1, because that's what we want to show. So remember, in the game, the idea is we start with any positive number n, and we modify this number n by two rules. And the question is, do we ever reach 1, or do we always reach 1? That's the question. So we assume here, because of that, that we have to keep on playing the game. We have to apply the two rules so long as we have not reached 1. So in other words, as long as n is not equal to 1, we have to execute these two steps here. And then I do the following. I first print out the n so that I see some intermediate output. And then I check if the number n that I currently have is even. That's what I do here. I use the modulo division by 2. And if there is no rest, then I know the number is even. And then what I do is I divide the number by 2 and replace it with this number. So in other words, I update n with the double slash equal operator or statement. So why the double slash? Well, we know by now that if I divide a number by another number with the single slash, then I will always get back a float. But here I don't want to get back a float because we've seen that floats are not precise, and we will study that further in chapter 5. So I use the double slash so that the number that I divide by will always, or that the division will always return another integer. And I know for sure that once I'm here in this line of code, that I can be sure that there will be no rest. Why? Because I've actually checked that, you know, a division by 2 works. So this will just divide by 2 without rest here because it's an even number. And in the case where we have an odd number, what I do is I take the old n, I multiply it by 3, and I add 1 and set it to my new n. And I play this game so long as the n is not yet 1. And once the n is 1, this condition will be false, and the loop will stop. And then at the end, I will just print out 1 because the last n will then be 1, of course. So I define the function, and now let's play the game. Let's start, for example, with the number n is equal to 100. So these are the numbers. 100 is even, so we divide by 2 to get 50. 50 is even, we divide by 2 to get 25. 25 is odd, so we multiply by 3, add 1 to get 76, and so on. And we see that at the end of the day, we reach the number one. And the question is, the theoretical question is, do we always reach one? So let's try another n, for example, 1,000. The series gets longer. This kind of makes sense to us because, you know, if we start with a higher number, reaching one should take longer. But we reach one. What happens if I call the function with 10,000? I also reach one, but the series becomes shorter again. And you see that is a problem. That's one of the reasons why it's so hard to prove mathematically if this game always reaches the one. But so far, nobody has proven it. So there is actually prize money on this game. So if you can prove mathematically that this game always reaches one, you will make some money. However, I have played with this game quite some time, and I've always reached one so far. However, that does not constitute a mathematical proof, because just because I show that the game works for a number n doesn't mean I can tell anything about the game working for n plus 1. Okay, then next. So we have seen the while statement at work. And now let's see. Look at the for statement. The for statement is really what is called syntactic sugar for the while statement. So what does syntactic sugar mean? Syntactic sugar in a programming language is syntax that we don't need to get to do any new features or to implement anything new. In other words, syntactic sugar are any syntax or construct in a programming language that don't provide any new capabilities to the programmer. However, they make life easier for the programmer by simplifying some use cases. So for example, most usages of the while statement kind of like work this. I am giving a sequence of numbers, for example, and I do something for every number in the sequence. So I could loop over a sequence manually with the while statement. But the for statement, as we will see, is really just an abbreviation. So let's look at the example. So I have here a list elements with the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And now I want to loop over these numbers and print them out one by one without using the for statement. So we have seen plenty of times how we would do that with a for statement, but now we want to do it with a while statement just to illustrate that you don't need the for statement. So how would we do that? Well, maybe let me insert a new line, a new code cell here. So just to repeat some concepts, now elements is defined. It's a list. And let's say I want to index into this list. I use the index operator, which are the brackets. And let's say I want to get out the first element in the list. We start counting at 0. So the first element in the list, I will get back as elements index 0. So this gives me back the 0. And just to illustrate the point that this is not just a 0 that we get back. I just overwrite the first element to be 99. And if I now ask for the first element, this would, of course, be the 99 as well. You get the point. If you don't, go back to chapter 1 and look at the example, who am I and how many in this chapter. Okay. So now this is 0 again. So now I want to automate this, and I want to go from beginning to end. So how do I do that? Well, I start with the index 0, and I have to go to the end, right? So how do I figure out what is the end? Well, I figure out the end with the built-in len function. The built-in len function gives me the number of elements in the list. So in this case, 5 elements. And now the question is, what is the largest possible index when I want to index into the list? Can I index with the number 5? And the answer is no, because when I start counting at 0, I can only index to len of elements minus 1. This works. This is the last element. In other words, this would, of course, be 4. OK, that's indexing, a short review on indexing. And now let's use a while loop to index. So at first, I set up a temporary variable called index. That is a variable I don't really want, but I need it. So I set it to 0 because I start indexing in the first element. And then I set up a while loop, and the condition is as follows: while the index is strictly smaller than the number of elements in the list, do the following. And then what do? Well, I use the index operator here in order to retrieve the next element by indexing. So I use the indexing operator and I get the element. So back here I have the elements list plural, and here I have a single element singular. And then what I do with the element, I print it out, and I end the print function with an empty space. So that means I'm printing all of the numbers on the same line. And then in the last line, I have to adjust my index. So in this case, I increment the index by one. In the countdown example before, I had to decrement the variable in the while loop by one. Here I have to increment the variable, so I say index plus equals one. This is what constitutes the file, the while loop. And so how does it work? So it starts at a zero. We get the first element, we add one, so index is one. The condition is still fulfilled. We go through it again. And at some point, index will be five, actually it will be four. And when index is four, what happens is four is strictly smaller than the length of elements, which is five. So index of four will be an index that works. And then we go back up to the condition, and index will now be five because we incremented by one. And then five is not strictly smaller than the length of elements, which is why this code block will not be executed one more time when index is five. So in other words, this loop will be executed for indices between zero and four, both including. And then at the end, after the while loop, because I don't really want the index variable, what I do here is I just dereference it. So I don't want, you know, the index variable to exist after the while loop. So let's execute this code, and I see the output. And of course, I can modify the output. For example, I can put a plus in between, and then I have all the numbers on one line and pluses in between. Okay, so let's go back without the plus. Maybe it looks a bit better. So now, how can we do the same thing with a for statement? Well, you guessed it probably. I just write for element singular in elements plural, and then print element. I execute this code, so I get the same output. So you get the point. This is the body of the for loop here, and this is exactly the same as this line of code. And now the observation to make is this line here in the for loop, this one line, the header line in the for loop, replaces those three lines and those two lines. So in other words, the for loop just saves us five lines with the file loop, or in other words, we save a total of four lines every time we use a for loop. And this is just to say that the for loop is just a special case of the while loop, okay? And we will get back to the for loop in detail, in much more detail, in chapter 7, when we talk about so-called iterators. So we have not yet learned everything about the for loop. There is actually a lot that still comes with the for loop. Okay, so let's continue. And what I have here, just to also make this explicit, I create a list. So let's maybe use our memory diagrams and quickly draw a picture of what happens in memory, because I want to show you some effects in memory as well. So what the first line does when I execute elements is equal to this list, what happens is a list object is created, and we know that a list object looks like this. It's this big so-called array of something, and an array consists of equally sized slots. And of course, the type of this thing is a list. And then I have somewhere a int object with the value zero, and this is referenced from the first slot. Then I have somewhere an int with the value one, and this is referenced from the second slot, and so on. Let me quickly draw everything. And also observe that it is absolutely intentional that all the int objects, they are not somewhere aligned. So they are like a little bit random in memory. We don't know when memory they are. And then once the list object is created, the name elements is put on the list here, and it also gets a reference to the list object here. So this is what we created here in memory, and we looped over the individual five objects here. And now let's contrast this with something else, namely the so-called range object or the range built-in. So in order to loop over the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, I can also say for element in range 5, print element. So let's execute this, and I get the exact same output as before. And so what is range, really? So range is a built-in that returns an object, and the object we will see is of type range, but we will look into this in detail in chapter 7. And what is range? So what is a range object? Let's create one. So as I said, the range 5 is an object of type range, and if I only write here range 5 and execute the cell, I get back a range object. So what is the range object? A range object is this. A range object, let's say, is an object like this. It is of type range, as we saw. And in this case, I don't have a name here, so maybe let's make up a name. Let's say r equals, and then I have a name r, and the name references the range object here. So just to reiterate here, or to emphasize the difference here, a list object contains references to all the objects, and the important observation is all the objects in the list, they exist simultaneously with the list together. So the elements list, which contains 5 objects, means that 6 objects exist in memory simultaneously, the list object plus 5 int objects. For the range, object, only one object exists. And what happens if I go ahead and loop over the range here? What happens in every iteration of the for loop? Python asks the range object, please give me the next your next integer. So what that means is, as this for loop here executes, I get back in the first iteration just one int object. So let's just do it again. I just maybe loop over just r, because I just created r, and we see we get the same output. So what just happened is, the first time around, the int object, let's move this up a little bit, the range object creates an int with the number 1 in it, and makes element singular reference it. And then I reach the second iteration of the loop, and what the range object does, somehow in memory, it removes this one here and removes the reference, and it creates another object with a 2 in it of type int, and makes the element name reference this one. And if I go into next iteration, the game goes on like this. So a big difference between a list and a range is that in a list, all the objects exist simultaneously, and I call this in this course, the list object is materialized. Materialized meaning all the objects are there in ones and zeros. In the range object, the objects are not there, but they get created on the fly. As I loop over the range, I get the individual objects back. So in other words, the range object is highly memory efficient, whereas the list object is not, because the list object requires us to have lots of memory available for all the objects in it. And so the question is, why do I tell you this? Well, the thing that you should observe is that just as I looped here over a list, I can also loop over something that is a range. So let's maybe go back and type range here. So I can, what I'm saying is I can loop over different types of objects. That's the important observation. And remember duck typing, which I introduced to you some moments ago. Duck typing means when I have two objects of different type that behave in a similar way in one aspect. And there is one aspect in which, in this case, the list and the range behave alike. And the aspect is within the context of a for loop. So in the context of looping, the list object and the range object, they behave alike, although they are different types of objects. And let's continue another example. So just to illustrate what range can do, let's say I want to loop over the list 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. So in other words, I want to start at 1 and I want to loop over every other number. So this of course works. However, this code, what it does, before the loop starts, it will go ahead in memory and it will create a list with the numbers 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9 in it. So it will just basically model it as if it was this list here. Now, how could I loop over these numbers without creating them all simultaneously? Well, I can use the range built-in, and I can tell the range built-in, well, please loop or please go from 1 to 10 in steps of 2. And as we have not yet seen maybe, but the left-hand side, the 1 is including, of course, and the right index, the upper index, is not included. And the names for these three arguments is the start value, the stop value, and the step value here. So if I execute this code here, I get the exact same output, but again with the implication that in the first code cell, all the objects exist in memory simultaneously, and in the second code cell, only two objects exist at most in memory. So first only this object exists, the range object, and then the range object spits out the integers one by one. And when an iteration in the loop is over, the int object goes away and the next int object comes into play. So the second, so the range is a lot more memory efficient. That is an important observation. And now, as I said that this has to do with how different types of objects behave, let's give the behavior a name. So anything I can loop over in Python is called an iterable. That's the technical term. And you will find this term in the Python documentation a lot. So whenever a function requires an object over which it can loop, the documentation will say, please pass in an iterable object. And I contrast this with another behavior, which I call the container behavior. And this is just to illustrate a point further. So let's look at another example. Let's look at the example of a new list called first names, which holds 5 German first names. And let's generate this. And now I can ask the question, is this name, this first name Achim, in the list first names? And the answer will be true. So in other words, what is in here? Well, in is the so-called membership testing operator. So in checks if the object on the left-hand side is contained in the object on the right-hand side. So what I'm looking at here is I'm not focusing on the fact that I can loop over first names. I am focusing on the idea that first names is a container and I can ask the question, is something contained in the list? In other words, the list type that we have seen a couple of times by now is not only iterable, it's also a container, it's both. So the important idea here is I just want to slowly make you or slowly prepare you for what is to come. Sometimes I focus on behavior, and for the behaviors we will use technical terms. And here the list type has two different behaviors that we like, and the one behavior is that it is an iterable, we can loop over it, and the other behavior that we like is that it is a container. And a container means I can ask it if it contains something. And for example, if I ask for my name here, Alexander, then it's obviously not contained in the list. Okay, so we just know now that iterable and container are two abstract concepts, and we will see that very importantly, a list object has in total four such properties or four such abstract concepts, and they together will make the meta concept of a so-called sequence. And this is what chapter 7 will be about. So we will focus a lot more on these abstract behaviors. So again, this is nothing new. I can loop over first names because first names is an iterable. So whenever something is iterable, maybe let me show you something in the Python docs. Library reference, the built-in functions here. There is a built-in function or built-in called enumerate. And just to illustrate the point, why am I teaching you these technical terms actually? Well, as I said in the introduction part to this course, I want to prepare you to read the documentation on your own without the help of a more experienced programmer. And the term iterable occurs quite often in the documentation. For example, with the enumerate built-in. And the enumerate built-in is a very nice thing to know whenever we need indices and don't want to manage them on our own. So enumerate, as we just saw, takes an iterable. And we also just learned that a list object is an iterable, which means I can pass first names, the list, to enumerate as the first argument because it's iterable. And then what enumerate does, it allows me to loop over something, but not only over the elements of the list in this case, but also over the indices that are provided. So enumerate spits out or generates indices for something that I am looping over. And I tell enumerate to start the indices at 1. So let me execute this code cell. So now I'm still looping over all the 5 names, but now I have an index for every name. And the index is automatically provided by the enumerate built-in. And if I go ahead and change the start, let's say, to 10, then the indices start at 10. So in other words, when I just showed you how the for statement is a special case of the while statement, we had to manage the index variable ourselves within the while statement. But whenever you feel that in the program you write, you want to work with an index, you shouldn't manage this on your own. You should always use the built-in enumerate to basically have indexes available for something you can loop over. You don't have to do this manually. You don't have to increment indices with plus equals 1 all the time. This is done for you automatically. Okay, so let's now look at a iterative version of the Fibonacci numbers. So again, the Fibonacci numbers are the sequence 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, and 13. And so on, of course. These are the first 7 or the first 8 Fibonacci numbers. So how can we calculate the Fibonacci numbers going from left to right? Because we saw when we calculate the Fibonacci numbers from right to left, this will result possibly in a exponential growth of function calls, which we don't like. So we rather want to calculate the Fibonacci numbers from left to right. So let's do that in code. And we do that with a for statement, a for loop, because the while, because we don't need to check for some condition as we did with the while loop. The for loop is a lot more convenient here. So how does this function work? Well, first, here I have the input, the type checking and the input validation. But just to make the function a bit shorter, I can remove it for now. So this is just just making sure that down here the I that is passed in as the argument is a positive integer. And then what happens in the code block of the function? Well, I start with two variables a and b. And I set them to 0 and 1. And what are 0 and 1? Well, these are the first two Fibonacci numbers that are by definition 0 or 1. And then I just print them out here, print AB, just so that I have some intermediate output. So also, I already tell you this beforehand. When you calculate something in a forward way, in an iterative way, you can often put in print statements or print function calls so that you see some intermediate results. And this is often not so easy to do with recursions. So here in this example here, you have two calls to the print function. And as you see with the comment, I added them only for deductible purposes. In a real solution, you would just leave out the print here because you don't want to have a side effect of prints. You only are interested in the returned value at the end. And then, so we start with A set to 0 and B set to 1. And then what do we have to do? Let's say I want to calculate the Fibonacci number with the index 7, so the 8th Fibonacci number. The question is now, how often do I have to loop? Well, let's check here in the example here. So if I'm given 0 and 1, I need one more step here, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So let me rephrase that. In order to calculate the Fibonacci number with the index 7, I need 6 loops. Right, the first two numbers are given, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 6 loops. So how do I get to 6 in this case? Well, let's say I is 7, as I said. So I want to loop over over the range in this case, because I don't even need all the numbers one by one. I just want to loop over them. So what I do here is I say I minus 1. So again, if I is 7 and I want 6 loops, so how do I get to the number of loops? Well, it would be 7 minus 1, which is 6. So here in the range built in, I just type I minus 1. So this would be 6 in the example. And then I go into a for loop. And then there is something that we have not seen before. The target variable in the for loop is an underscore here. What does the underscore mean? Well, this is a convention. So underscore is a legal variable name. So this actually works, but it's a convention to communicate that we are not interested in this number here or in this variable. In other words, the range built in will give us back the numbers 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And we don't need them. And if we don't need them, we just show that with the underscore here. Okay, so and then what do we do? Well, then we go ahead and we create a temporary variable and we get it by adding A plus B. So in other words, what is temp? Well, temp is the next Fibonacci number in line. We take the two old Fibonacci numbers to start with 0 and 1, and we calculate the next Fibonacci number. So in this case, when A is 0 and B is 1, then the next Fibonacci number, temp, would be the sum of A and B. So this one would be 0 plus 1. This is why we calculate temp this way. And then what we do is we set A to whatever B was set to, and then we set B to whatever temp is setting to. So in other words, what I do here is I start with A and so let me, where can we put it? Maybe let's say here. So here's A and B. So we start with A and B with 0 and 1. And so then we go into the first iteration of the loop. I calculate temp, and temp is 0 plus 1, which would be 1. And then I go ahead and I take B and I write it here to where the A was pointing to. So A is now 1. And then B is set to temp. So this one goes here. So this one goes here, and this one is gone. Okay. So in the next iteration of the loop, so the loop runs, I'm here, and then I have some print, which is not important for this problem. I go back up to the for, to the header line, and run all over again. And then I calculate my second temp, and the second temp would be 1 plus 1, so this would be 2, so temp is now 2. And then I go ahead in the next two lines, and I set A to B, so B is now 1, so A will remain 1, and then B is set to temp, so B will be set to 2. And then one more time I will do it in the next iteration of the loop. I will calculate temp as 1 plus 2, which is 3. So we override temp. And then I go ahead and I use the B, which is 2, and I put it where the A is. And then I set B equal to 3. So in other words, I only keep track, what the for loop effectively does is, I only keep track of the last two numbers in the line. And that's all I need to calculate the next Fibonacci number 9. So at most, I will always have three numbers. So the last two that I added and the next one, which is temp. And then I just reset all of them and I calculate the next one. In other words, I just calculate always the next Fibonacci number. This is what the for loop does. And again, if I want to calculate the Fibonacci number, for example, with an index of 7, I need 6 iterations because the first two numbers are already there. So I don't have to make any loop here, in order to calculate those numbers they are already given. Okay, so let's go on and calculate Fibonacci with an index of 12, the 13th Fibonacci number, and it's still 144 as before, but now I also see this nice intermediate result. And this comes from the fact that I have the debugs, the print functions in here for debugging purposes, or as I call it, for didactical purposes, so that you see how the Fibonacci number grows. And then the 12th or the 13th Fibonacci number is just 144. And now let's look at the efficiency of this new algorithm again. So this iterative version of the Fibonacci algorithm is now extremely efficient. So let's calculate the 100th Fibonacci number, and we get it. The only problem here is I don't see the cell output. Why? Because I configured my Jupyter notebook or my Jupyter lab here such that the output is limited. So maybe let's go ahead and calculate Fibonacci of 36. This is the one that took around about 7 seconds to calculate in the recursive version. And now I get this number and it works. And if I go, let's say, to 50 to give you one more, this also works. And the algorithm is super fast. And we have, you know, and the reason why it's super fast is because we simply calculate the Fibonacci numbers in a linear way, and we don't have this exponential growth of function calls here. Okay, let's go on and let's also look at the factorial function in an iterative version. This is actually even simpler. So here the revised version of factorial still takes a parameter n. It does type checking and input validation. I will remove it for now so that you can basically easier read it. And then what I do here is, how can I calculate the factorial in a forward way? Well, maybe let's take a new piece of paper and see what is the pattern for the factorial. So let's say 3 factorial is defined as 3 times 2 times 1, and then also technically times 0. No, not times 0. It's times 0 factorial, of course. But of course, this would be 6. And now the thing is this. In the recursive version, what I did is I calculated the factorial in the direction from descending order. So I started with the large number 3, and I used the descending order. But in multiplication, I can, of course, also say that 3 factorial is the same as 1 times 2 times 3, which is, of course, also 6. So I can go the other direction, so to speak. And so what does this tell me? Well, this tells me that if I start with a product that I set to 1, and the reason why I set this to 1 is because 0 factorial is 1, and then I just go into a for loop, and then I run the for loop exactly n times. Why n times? Well, I start the for loop at 1, so this would be this one here. And then let's say I want to calculate the factorial of 3, so n is 3. I want to have 3 iterations in the loop, and the iteration should have 1, 2, and 3. So in order for the for loop to get to 3, I have to have an upper limit of 4 here, because we learned that the range built in has its left argument included, but its right argument is excluding. So this is the start number 1 that is included in the range, and this is the stop number of 4, which is excluded. So this will create a for loop going over 1, 2, and 3. And then we go ahead and we basically update our product. So in the first loop, so in other words, our product starts out as 1. So our product starts out as 1. And then I go into the first loop here. And that means I multiply this by 1 to obtain 1. And then I go into my second loop, which means I multiply this by 2. So I have my product of 1 times 2 now, which is 2. And then I do another loop here. And then I have the 2 here. And I multiply this by 3 to get 6. And this is how I get the factorial in a forward way. And note that, so these are the intermediate products here. So I call this here kind of like this is similar to a running product, so to say. So we've seen in the first example in chapter one what a running total is and what a running total looks like. And this is kind of like a running product. So I always multiply on the next number, starting with one. So one times one is one. Then I take the one as an intermediate result. I multiply by two, I get two. This is my next intermediate result. And then I multiply by three here to get six, which is the next intermediate result. So these are the running products, so to say. And let's see if this function works. And I also, just to note, I put in one print here, so that I also can see the intermediate results, the intermediate product here. So let's try out this function. I call factorial with 3, and I get back a return value of 6. This is the output here. And then up here, I see the intermediate product. And these are the exact same products, 1, 2, and 6. And this is what I see here as well. OK, so let's go on. So now we have seen the for loop. The for loop is a special case of the while loop. And now let's see how can we customize the for and while loops. What I'm about to show you, I will only show you for the for loop, but everything that I'm about to show you also works for the while loop. So let's look at the following example. Let's say I have my list numbers again that I know that we know from the first chapter. The numbers from 1 to 12, and I asked the question whether or not any of the numbers has a square that is greater than 100. That's the question I'm asking. So how can I write code that checks that? So let's start. I create numbers list with the numbers that we know from before, and now this is the code that does exactly that. So what does this code do? Well, first, it starts by saying, by setting a variable is above to false. So our initial assumption is that none of the numbers here in the list has a square that is greater than 100. That's our initial assumption. And then I loop over the individual numbers one by one, and I print them out for didactical purposes again. And then for every individual number, I raise it to the power of 2. So number to the power of 2. And I check if that is strictly greater than 100, because that's the question. And when that is the case, I set is above to true. And then after the for loop, I have a compound if statement, which only checks if is above is true or false. And if it is true, then I know that at least one number in this list has a square that is greater than 100. OK, so let's execute this code. And I indeed get the result that at least one number satisfies the condition. OK, what is the problem here? Well, the problem here is that we see that the for loop obviously runs over all the elements in the list. And that's bad. Why is that bad? Well, we know that already the second element in the list, the 11, has a square. 11 squared is 121. So the second element in the list has a square that already fulfills this condition. And now if the question, and you have to be careful here, the question was, is the square of a number in the list greater than? So it's sufficient for the condition to be fulfilled if there's only one number. It doesn't matter where this number is. So in other words, the number 11 already fulfills this condition. And now I'm still continuing the for loop, and that's totally useless, right? Because we already know that the condition is fulfilled. So what can we do? There is the so-called break statement. And the break statement helps us or allows us to break out of a loop. And how can we use it? So here's a re-implementation of the code. So I still have my initial assumption that no number is above, no number's square is above 100. And then I loop over the numbers one by one again, and I check the same condition again, and then I set is above to true. Once I find that a number fulfills the condition, I set is above to true, and then I just write break. Break is a statement, and what break does is whenever we hit break, Python leaves the innermost enclosing loop. So there is only one loop here, the for loop. So once we hit this break here, Python stops the for loop. It simply stops, and then Python continues to read the code here. And here we only check if there is a number that fulfills the condition or not. So let's execute this. And now I like the program already better. So we only loop over two elements, and the second element fulfills the condition. And because of that, the condition is fulfilled for the entire list, because that's the question we wanted to solve or to answer. And this code is now more efficient. However, in the worst case scenario, if there is not a single element in the list whose square is beyond or larger than 100, then this wouldn't work. So let's, for example, change the 100 to 1000. So I know that this the search condition is not fulfilled for a single number. And what this means is I still go over all the elements. So again, when we analyze how a program or how code behaves, we are sometimes interested in what is the average performance of an algorithm, and sometimes we are interested in what is the worst case performance of an algorithm. And the worst case performance of this algorithm still means we have to go over the entire list. So this is an example of what is called a linear search. And linear search means we are given a list of things or a sequence of things, and we have to go in the worst case scenario from the first to the last element in order to find out what we are looking for. And there is no faster way of doing this in the worst case. So in the worst case, we just have to go over all the elements. There is nothing that prevents that. Okay, so let's make this code a little bit nicer with the so-called optional else clause. And now you may wonder, why else? We have seen else before. It belongs to the compound if statement. So let me maybe go back. What I don't like about this code here, it works. It is, in a way, efficient. However, I still have like three different sections here. I have a section above where I initialize something. Then I have the actual search logic. And then I have some logic at the end that checks if the search was successful or not. So the code is kind of like divided into three different sections. And this I don't like. I want to express the code in a nicer way, in a more concise way. How do I do that? I use, for example, the optional else clause. How does it look like? Well, obviously, the initializing code up here is gone. And now I loop over the numbers. And if a single number has a square larger than 100, then I set is above to true, and I break out the loop. So this part is exactly the same as before. And now there is this else clause here. And note this is correct, right? So the else clause belongs to the for. It does not belong to the if syntactically. So syntactically, the else belongs to the for. And in the else clause, I set is above to false. And now how do you read this? Well, you read it like this. We loop over the for loop. And in the situation where we don't break out of the loop, we will go into the else clause. However, if we break out of the loop, we don't go into the else clause. So in other words, conceptually, the if here and the else, they still go together. So either we hit the condition in the if statement is fulfilled, in which case we hit the break statement and we set is above to true. But if we never do that, then after the loop is over, Python executes this one line here. And that's the optional else clause. Not many languages have that, but it's something that is very worthwhile to know. And unfortunately, not many people that work in Python know that this is possible. But you can see the paradigm here. So we are searching for something in a list. And if we don't find anything, we do something. So this search pattern here, this is something that we will often do with data. And so I think it's quite worthwhile to know the optional else clause. And again, syntactically, the else belongs to the for, but conceptually, the else goes together with the if. So we either do this here, or we do this here. And then afterwards, I still have to check if is above is set to true or false. And the code still works as before, and it's still as inefficient in the worst case as it was before. Let's quickly set this to 1000, and it still has to go to the end, so it doesn't change anything with the runtime here. And now I still want to improve this code. I would like to get rid of this last section. I want to basically put this somewhere inside the for loop. How can I do that? Well, that's quite easy. I just do it. I just copy paste the prints inside the for loop, and I get rid of the isAbove variable at all. So now this is the most concise version of this search. And if I execute this, it's efficient. It stops with the first element that fulfills the condition. It breaks out. And if the condition is not fulfilled, we run to the end as before. And we don't have three different sections in the code. We only have one compound for statement. And this, in my opinion, is not just shorter, but this way of formulating the problem also conveys the idea of the problem in a better way. Okay, so the optional so we've learned the break statement and the optional optional else clause. So we and they can also be used, as I said, for the while loop as well. And now let's look at something else that also helps us to make for and while loops nicer. So here's an example. It's about filtering something. So here's the example. So we are given the same list as always, the numbers from 1 to 12 in unordered fashion. And the task is to calculate the sum of all even numbers in this list of numbers after squaring them and adding 1 to the squares. So let's kind of translate what this task wants us to do. So it says calculate the sum of all numbers in a list, and the all implies we have to loop over the list. And then it says calculate the sum of all even numbers. So even is kind of like it's basically a filter. It means that we don't want to do something for all the elements in the list, but only for some. So we want to filter something out. And then at the end of the day, we say the individual numbers in this list, we don't want to just work with them as they are. We want to square them and add 1 to them. And what is that? Square and add 1. Well, this is what a programmer would call a map. So we map an x, namely the element in the list, to an y by a function. So what is the mapping function here? Well, we square it and we add 1. So y is f of x, and x squared plus 1. That's the mapping. And then at the end, in the last step, for all the remaining numbers after filtering that are mapped, we want to sum them up. And whenever I start with many numbers and I want to so-called reduce them into one summary statistic, so to say, then we call this a reduction. And this is where the terms filter, map, and reduce come from. And in other words, the so-called map, filter, reduce paradigm is a paradigm that is quite often used when we work with big data. And my claim is that as business people, whenever we work with matrix-like data, and many data that we work with is matrix-like, because everything that fits into an Excel sheet is at the end of the day matrix data, then chances are very high that whatever we want to do with the numbers, whatever analysis we want to do with the numbers, can be broken down into steps that belong to one of three categories: filter, map, and reduce. And now, for now, this may seem a little bit too theoretical, but you can trust me on that. Whenever you are able to break your problem, whatever you have, your concrete problem, when you break it down into these three different steps, map, filter, and reduce, then you can be sure that A, you will find many, many standard algorithms that solve the individual steps quite efficiently. And also, you can most likely scale your solution up to loads of data. And so map, filter, reduce paradigm has a little bit to do with parallelized computers or parallel computation of things and so on. So this is what you need to know in the back of your head when you want to scale a problem up to a big data set. Okay, so let's implement this. So we have the same numbers list. And here is the code that does all of that. And it's very similar to the first example in chapter 1. So we start here with a total. We set it to 0. And then we loop over the individual numbers. And then we filter out the odd numbers. So we have an if statement that says if number modulo divided by 2 has no rest, so if the number is even, then what we do with all the even numbers is we square them and we add 1 to them and we store that as a square. And then I just print it out for debugging so that we see intermediate output. And then we take the square and we add it up on the running total. So that's exactly the same logic we have done in chapter 1 in the first example. And then when I execute this code, what happens is the loop goes over the 12 numbers, but only 6 numbers are kept, namely the even numbers. And then we see how the even numbers, 8, 12, 2, and so on, how are they mapped to their transformed numbers. So 8 is squared to 64 plus 1 gives me 65, and so on. And then I add up 65, 145, 37, the 5 also, 101, 17, and this leads to 370. Okay, that's the example. And this is nothing new, actually. So we have seen this before, just with a different task. And now, let's try to extend this. Let's try to have a second filter. So here's the task again, just a little bit modified. Calculate the sum of every third and even number in this list after squaring them and adding 1 to the squares. So what do we read here? So the every here still means we have the loop. The third, every third number in the list means we have a filter. We only keep every third number in the list. And then it says every third and even number, so even remains. So we have 2 filters now. And then we also still square the number and add 1, and we still sum them up. So the last 2 steps are the same. The only thing that's different is we have a second filter. Let's try to model this in code. How can we do that? Well, first, I use the built-in enumerate that we just saw before that gives me indexes. I wrap it around numbers. So now I loop over numbers. But in addition to the number, I also get an index variable. And enumerate by default bases the indexes off of 0. But when I give it a optional start argument of 1, then the first index will be 1. And this makes sense here, because if I want to filter out every third element, it's better when I start counting at 1 here and not at 0. So in every iteration of the loop, I get a new index and the next number. And then I check if the index is divisible by 3. If so, I know that I have a third number. So divisible by 3 means this is the third number, the sixth number, the ninth number, and the 12th number. These are the numbers that survive the filter. That's the first filter. And only numbers that pass this filter get processed here. So, and then we check with a second if statement if the number is also even. Okay, so we can do this. And then what happens is we have the same logic, but now we have 2 levels of indentation. Okay? I can execute this. And now the 8 I look at, it's even, so I keep it. The 12 I look at, it's even, I keep it. The 9 I look at, but it's not even, so I skip it. The 4 I look at, it's even, and I keep it. So it remains 8, 12, and 4. I square them, add 1 to them, and I get 227. So now, what's bad with this code? What I don't like here is that I indent too much. So we have this artificial limit of 80 characters per line that we don't want to skip over. So by adding more levels of indentation, there is a risk that we get closer and closer to this red line here. However, I would also argue that this code is a bit harder to read because, you know, I have to understand, hey, what's going on here? What's going on here? What's going on here? So I have to read from in a horizontal way, so the code grows horizontally. And you know, programmers, they like code that grows vertically. So how can I do that? There are 2 ways. The first one is, of course, I could use an AND here, the logical AND operator, and connect the 2 conditions into 1 if statement. This would work. This would save me 1 level of indentation. However, this would make the if statement a bit more complex. And you know, because I'm checking for 2 different filters, I don't want to intermingle the 2 if statements, really. Because if in the real world there are 2 things, then 2 different conditions that are independent of each other, I don't want to have 1 line of code that, you know, puts them together. I try to model the world as it is and not more complex. So if I have two conditions or two filters that I want to be fulfilled, I model that with two if statements, preferably. So what can I do alternatively? Well, Python has the so-called continue statement here. And the continue statement, what it does is, it basically, within the for loop, when the for loop hits continue, Python immediately goes into the next iteration of the for loop. That's all. In other words, what we do here is, I check now for the opposite. So I check in this first line of code here, first if statement, if the number is not a third number in the list. And if it's not a third number, then I continue. Continue meaning I go to the next iteration in the loop. I skip it. And then in my second, in the elif branch here, I check if the number is not even, so if it's odd. And in case I find an odd number, I just continue. I just skip the next iteration in the loop. And then I have my actual code, my actual logic that I want to apply, the transformation or the mapping, as we call it, and the reduction. And I have it totally unindented. So I have it on the same level of indentation here. And this is nice. So if I run this code, first of all, it works as before. So I didn't introduce any bug here. But then now conceptually, it's a lot easier to read because I have all my filters here one by one. So now if I asked you to add a third or a fourth or a fifth filter, how would you do that? Well, you would just add on, you know, more elifs here, basically. And then it's absolutely clear. You have one condition per filter. You can nicely document it here, or maybe you have some self-explanatory variable and whatever here. But then for every filter we have one line of code. And then we know that if any of these is reached, we just skip the element, skip the number. So this is very easy to read. And then we know, once we're down here when reading this code, that when we are here, we know the filters are all passed. So now we can take care of the mapping and the reduction. So I think this code is a little bit nicer. And there are companies like Google, for example, that also enforce coding styles where they don't want their programmers to indent too much. So many companies actually have this. So you don't want to indent your code too much. And the continue statement is a nice way of not having to indent code within a for loop. Okay, let's get to the last section in this chapter. And let's see what else can we do with the loops. So in particular, we can use a while loop, as we will see, to model something that I call an indefinite loop. So what is an indefinite loop? An indefinite loop is, for example, a computer that asks you to enter a number, and like, let's say in a game or so, the computer asks you to enter a number, and you enter the number, and or let's say you don't enter a number, you enter something invalid, and then what should the computer do? The computer should keep asking you, it should tell you, okay, you entered something wrong, please enter a correct, a correct number or something. So it wants to ask you to do something until you do it. So what this tells us, we know that some code has to be repeated, and it has to be repeated until a point where some condition is fulfilled, but we don't know what the condition really is. The condition lies like, the condition is a bit, it's random in a way. So we know in this game example, the loop will eventually end, but we don't know when. We don't know when the user is able to enter something valid. To give you an example, let's try to implement a game that is called guessing a coin toss. So what will happen here is we will model the tossing of a coin, and then we will ask our user to enter, to make a guess if the coin came up heads or tails. And if the guess is correct, the game is over and the user won. And if the guess is not correct, we will throw another coin and the user will guess again. So we can already see this game will eventually end, but we don't know exactly when. So we cannot formulate any condition when this game will end. it depends on the user. So how would we formulate this? Well, first, let's import the random module. And then, of course, for good practices, set a random seed. And then here is the game, the first version. So in the first line, we say while true. So when is the condition here true? Well, true is always true. So in other words, this condition here leads to an infinite loop. So this loop would run forever if we did not break out of it. And we see already two break statements. And I already mentioned that we can use the break statement also within a while loop, not only within a for loop. So now we know that this loop would run forever unless we hit one of the two break statements. So let's analyze this code a little bit further. So what's the first line here doing? So the first line uses the Python's built-in input function. And what the input function does, it will prompt the user with a text message and allow the user to enter something as a, you know, via the keyboard. And whatever comes back from the user is stored in a variable called guess. And then we go into the first if statement here. So note there are three different if statements, an outer one and two nested ones. And the outer if statement draws a random number with the random function in the random module, and the random function in the random module gives us a number between 0 and 1, a float between 0 and 1 that is uniformly distributed. And we compare that to 0.5. In other words, in 50% of the cases, this condition here, the condition that is now in focus, this condition will be true. In 50% of the cases, this condition will not be true. And then we say that whenever this condition is true, we say, okay, we assume that the computer threw heads. And in the other case, in the else branch, we assume that the computer threw tails. And then we compare the guess by the user with either the word heads or the word tails. And if the user guessed correctly, then we will say, yes, it was heads, or yes, it was tails. And we will break out of the loop. If the user, however, did not guess correctly, we will just print the message, oops, it was, and then we will tell the user what it was. And then what happens is there is no break statement in those two branches here. So what will happen is the loop will continue in the last line, but there is no last line, which means is the flow of execution will go back up to the start, and we will run from the beginning. So in other words, the user will get a second chance or a third chance. So let's run this. So here's the prompt. And now I can, let's say, write, I want heads. I guess heads now. And unfortunately, the coin toss was tails. So let me guess again. Let's guess heads again. Ooh, and now something happens, something weird. So I guessed heads, and the computer tells me, oops, it was heads. So something must be buggy here. So what happened? Well, if we look closely in the lines of code where we check if the guess is equal to heads or if the guess is equal to tails, we compare it to the lowercase word. In other words, since Python is a case sensitive, typing in the guess with an uppercase H for heads in heads will result in an bad input. So even if we guessed correctly, we will not win the game. So let's write heads in lowercase. And luckily, we win. So now we want to improve this code a bit. And what don't I like here? So two things that I don't like here. The first thing is, of course, there is a bug. So somehow we need to allow the user to enter the input with an uppercase H. And then the second thing I don't like is there are really two things going on in this problem. First, the computer tosses a coin. And then second, the user makes a guess. However, in the code, those two independent steps, they are somehow modeled together. I don't like this. So in a way, as I said before, if some problem in the real world consists of two independent steps, I don't want to see code that intermingles these two steps. I don't want my code to be more complex than reality. I want my code to be a simpler model or a simple model of the world. So let's see how can we improve that. Remember that in chapter 2, we also talked about how to modularize code, and that's exactly what we will do. So we will write a function getGuess. And the function, it has a nice doc string, of course, but then what does it do? Well, the function, let's actually read the doc string. So the function processes the user's input. And the function takes no arguments and returns either a string or the none type. And it says either heads or tails if the input can be parsed and none otherwise. So this function already takes care of the user passing in something invalid. So how do we implement it? So we have the built-in input function here. The built-in input function prompts the user a message, and then whatever the user enters will become a string, an object of type string in Python. And this string is assigned to the variable guess. And then what do? In the second line of code, we call methods on the guess, on the guess object. First, we call a method called .strip, and then we call another method on it called .lower. So what does .strip do? .strip gets rid of leading and trailing white space. So in other words, if we prompt the user to enter something and the user accidentally hits the space key first before entering heads or tails, then this space will be ignored. That's what the .strip does. And then .lower does what we think it does, right? It just lowercases all the characters. And then whatever we get back from guess will be stored in guess again. And then, so now down here, once we reach this here, we know that we have a text string that is all lowercase. And so now what we do is we use the in operator that we saw before, the container property of the list, and check if the guess is in the list of the words heads and tails. So the list contains only two elements, the strings heads or tails. And as we saw, the in operator just checks if the operand on the left hand side is in the operand, is contained in the operand on the right hand side. And if it is, then we just return it as is, because then we know it is either heads or tails. So if this condition is true, we know that guess is either heads or tails, so we just return that. Otherwise, we return none, and the none will mean the user entered something that is invalid, something that could not be read as either heads or tails. Okay. So that's the getGuess function, and now we have another function, tossCoin, and the tossCoin function takes an argument called pheads, and it defaults to 0.5. So what this means is, this function will model the coin toss. However, it is parameterized, and that's a nice thing, because that means we can now by default model a fair coin, but by just changing the argument we pass to the tossCoin function, we can also model an unfair coin. And then, so how does this function work? Well, the code is rather simple, or let's actually read the doc string, what it's supposed to do. So it takes a probability, which is a float between 0 and 1. We don't validate the input here. We assume that pheads is just between 0 and 1. And then it returns at a string, either heads or tails. So this function now does not return none. It always returns heads or tails. How is it implemented? Well, if the random number drawn from by the random function in the random module is below pheads, then it is heads. So in other words, if we pass in pheads of, let's say, 0.8, then in 80% of the chances, this line, the line return heads, will be executed. And in the other case, return tails will be executed. So we also use the early exit pattern here, because after the first return statement, no more line will be executed, so we don't need the else here. And so this function just gives us back one of two strings. And now we have to glue those two functions together. How do we do that? I use a while true loop, so an infinite loop to start with. And then I call getGuess, and I store the result into guess. So guess, after this first line of code, is one of three values. It is either heads in lowercase, or tails in lowercase, or none. And then After that function is executed, we execute the next function, the toss coin. We store this in the variable called result, and this will be either lowercase heads or lowercase tails. And now I have three different cases that I need to take care of. So first, I check if guess is none. Please don't be confused that we don't write it like this. I don't write it with a double equal. This would also work. But whenever you compare something to none, you should use the is operator, the identity operator. That's just the best practice. Just accept that. And this has to do with the fact that none is a singleton. This is just what we do. And then if what is the case if guess is none? Well, we know in this case the user must have entered something invalid, in which case we print out a nice error message and tell the user, hey, please enter something correctly. And then in the elif branch here, we check if guess has the same value as result. And this is either true or false. And if it is true, then we know the user guessed correctly. And then we just print out, yes, it was result, because now we know result is whatever the correct result is. And then, of course, we must not forget to break out of the loop. And in the other case, in the case where the user misguessed the coin toss, we just print out, oops, it was result. So let's execute this code cell again. And let's for now just enter a text that is invalid. Enter it, and then we get a nice error message saying, make sure to enter something correctly. And now let's add two spaces here and write heads with a capital H. And I get back tails. It was tails. So let's do it again and hope we guess it correctly. It's still not correct. So three times in a row, we now have tails. This is something that happens. It's quite unlikely. So let's try it one more time, and now it works. So three times the same side of a coin, when crossing a coin several times, is a highly unlikely event. It just happened. I think the code is still correct, so it should work. And we see that the white space was ignored, and heads with an uppercase H does not cause any problems. It works. Okay, so we have taken care of both of the downsides. The first downside being the problem or the code was buggy. And the second one is we had two independent steps in practice, and we modeled it with like one, you know, intermingled code fragment. And here the code is totally isolated. So the guessing of the toin, is totally independent of the tossing of the coin. And I like that a lot better because this means my code is not more complex than reality. Okay, this concludes the last slide in this presentation. So I briefly summarize what we have learned in this chapter. So in this chapter, we talked about different ways of how to implement an iteration logic. Iteration meaning we execute code repetitively. There are two major approaches. One is recursion, the other one is looping. And we've seen that even though in memory, both of them are a little bit different, there are actually cases where recursion can provide a good solution, where it is hard to find a good solution with looping. Generally, looping should be the more common case. And usually, it is enough to loop with the for loop, with the for statement. But the for statement, as we saw, is just syntactic sugar for the while statement. And the while statement allows us to loop, to check a condition and loop as long as a condition is true. We have seen also cases where both kinds of iteration go wrong. So we've seen infinite recursions. We have seen infinite loops. And then also here, we have seen another case, which is the indefinite loop. And I think the indefinite loop is quite nice, because it allows us to code up games. And you will probably, in the first couple of examples, in your first couple of weeks of coding, mostly use the for loop and a little bit of the while loop. I think you won't work too much with recursion in the beginning. If you want, in the exercises, you will find a very popular recursion example, which is called the Towers of Hanoi. And you can look at this. And this is a problem which you can only solve by recursion, and which is also, you know, a classical problem. So it's very well studied, and you should also look at into that. And then as you get better in programming, more experienced, if you want to solve problems from the field, let's say supply chain management and logistics, you should learn about a field called dynamic programming, which is, you know, which also in, which is from conceptually similar to what we learned in with the recursion. So we solve a problem from the end backward in a backwards fashion, and many problems in supply chain management are solved this way. And so it's definitely worthwhile to know what a recursion is. And if you don't get recursion the first time around, that is absolutely no problem. I think recursion is a topic that is quite challenging to some people, but you should, if you don't understand it, keep on repeating it until you get it. Because as I said, there are nice applications with it. And other than that, we saw the first time that we have the list object. We looked at the concrete list object and tried to analyze some of its abstract behaviors. And we said that it has two properties that we identified in this chapter. The first property of a list is that we can loop over it. And any object that can be looped over, we call it an iterable. And then also the second property was that a list object contains other objects. And we also saw that, also see that, of course, when we draw a list in memory, where a list is nothing but a collection of references to other objects. So it truly, a list object is nothing but a container for other objects. And then we said that these two properties are independent of each other. And as we will see in chapter 7, then finally, list objects have a total of four independent abstract concepts behind them, and together this will make up the so-called idea of a sequence. And sequential data is one of the most common ways of data we will look at as business people, so this is very worthwhile to study. And yeah, other than that, this is it. In the next chapter, chapter 5, we will look at numbers in detail, and we will come back to the fourth statement in detail also in chapter 7.